Good evening. I'll be presenting a study on the evaluation of postictal MRI changes. The first description of focal periictal hypoperfusion is from the 1930s by Gibbs and Penfield. In the 1960s, a study utilizing pneumocephalograms noted that focal ictal activity is in one hemisphere could result in ipsilateral cerebral edema with subsequent cerebral atrophy and ventricular dilatation. Seizures are known to occur in 10% of the population during their lifetime. In addition, periictal neurologic deficits and neurological imaging findings of cerebral cortical T2 hyperintensity and diffusion restriction are well-known mimics of other CNS diseases such as stroke. Also, pre- and postictal changes on both anatomic and functional imaging examination have been recognized for many years. Although an exact explanation of these imaging abnormalities is still unclear, seizure-related changes on various imaging studies are believed to be a reflection of pathological, pathophysiologic alteration concerning seizure activity. According to the wide range of possible seizure-related lesions on neuroimaging studies, various disease entities are considered as a differential diagnosis, resulting in a potential risk of misdiagnosis and incorrect clinical management. Hence, there is a necessity to differentiate whether neuroimaging abnormalities in patients with seizure are caused by seizure itself or other underlying pathological conditions such as stroke. With a wide availability of MRI and PET, a growing range of recognized acute imaging findings can be classified as either local or remote with respect to site of maximal ictal EEG abnormality. The aim of this study was to evaluate the pattern and distribution of MRI signal changes in patients with immediate postictal period. The materials and method, this is a retrospective study carried out in our institution between August 2020 to August 2021. The records of postictal signal changes on MRI brain were extracted from radiology department database. The inclusion criteria is all patients with history of seizure who have undergone MRI brain within 24 hours of onset of seizure. Exclusion criteria included the patients with metabolic disorders, tumors, HIE, congenital malformations, infections, and genetic abnormalities were excluded. MRI brain performed after 24 hours of the onset of seizure was also excluded. A total of 10 patients were included in the study after the inclusion and exclusion criteria was met. All patients underwent MRI brain at our institution, and the imaging was carried out with the Siemens Magneton Essenza 1.5 Tesla MRI scanner. The sequences included axial T1 weighted, axial coronal and sagittal T2 weighted, axial and coronal flare, axial DWI and EDC maps, and SWI sequences. Imaging analysis, evaluation of signal changes, location of the lesion, and evidence of any diffusion restriction on DWI and EDC maps was done. The population characteristic, the mean age of the patients was about 7.6 years, ranging from 2 months to 16 years of age. It showed a male predominance with male to female ratio of 9:1. Clinical presentation, seizure, the status epilepticus was seen in 4 cases, a generalized tonic-clonic seizure was seen in 3, focal seizures were seen in 3 cases, and fever was seen in about 2 of the 10 patients. The average time from seizure onset to MR imaging was about 10.1 hours. The imaging features in our study is 7 out of 10 patients had cortical and subcortical areas of altered signal intensity, which appeared as T2 and flare hyperintensity in 4 cases. The same cases in the 2 cases of which showed the T1 hypointensity. Diffusion restriction was seen in 7 cases. Unilateral involvement was seen in 20% cases, and bilateral involvement was seen in 50% cases. No single lobar cortical lesion was observed in the study. And the rest of the three patients out of 10 patients had hippocampal involvement, wherein T2 flare hyperintensity was seen in 1 case, diffusion restrictions were seen in 1 case, and the hippocampus appeared bulky in 1. Follow-up imaging was done in 2 cases. After one was done after 4 days after initial imaging, and the other was done after 10 days. Contrast study was done in 2 cases, and no abnormal enhancement was seen. MRA was also done in 2 cases, which turned out to be normal. This is a case of a 2-year-old male patient with complaints of generalized tonic-clonic seizures. On T2 and flare images, you can see that there are bilateral symmetrical hyperintensities in the frontal and parietal lobes. These area shows diffusion restriction on DWI and ADC maps. This is another case of a 10-year-old patient with a history of repeated seizures. Here you can see areas of restricted diffusion in the frontal, bilateral, frontal, parietal lobes, which are symmetrical in distribution. This is another case of a 16-year-old male patient with a history of status epilepticus. This is the initial imaging which showed areas of hyperintensity in this DWI image. This is a follow-up imaging done 4 days later. You can see that these hyperintensities are disappear. So therefore, these suggest that there is these signal changes are only transient. This is another case of a 12-year-old male patient who shows that there is the hippocampus is mildly bulky on the right side, and there is quite asymmetry between the hippocampus. So a discussion, MR signal changes in patients with status epilepticus has been reported previously. These signal changes are likely to be caused by vasogenic or cytotoxic edema, increased permeability, loss of autoregulation, regional ischemia, excitotoxicity, which is seen as areas of hyperintensity on T2 and flare images in cortical gray matter or subcortical white matter, variable alteration in the DWI and ADC maps, mild mass effect, no contrast enhancement. The findings of this study was consistent with the previous study with seizure-related cortical abnormalities, with our study showing 7 out of 10 patients with the cortical abnormalities. Hippocampus was a common location of a seizure-induced brain abnormality, has been well documented. In our study, there are 3 out of 10 cases which show hippocampal involvement. Previous studies have also suggested the thalamus to be also involved in various epilepsy syndromes. To conclude, MRI signal changes seen in the immediate postictal period are hyper-intense signal on T2-weighted and diffusion-weighted images in the cortical gray matter and subcortical white matter or the hippocampus. The typical distribution of these lesions can help exclude the epileptogenic structural lesions. Therefore, an awareness of clinical and radiological findings can help to differentiate seizure-related cortical lesions from other CNS disorders and reducing the risk of inappropriate management in clinical practice. These are my references. Thank you.